What struck you the most during this first week of testimony in the Derek Chauvin murder trial? Because we heard a lot of it was painful.
Yeah, exactly. I think pain is a good word. You know, I've been thinking about trauma and the way that it has shown up throughout this trial. First of all, this is a real cultural event around these issues of anti-blackness and police violence against black people. It's very rare that we see this live on TV. You know, typically these cases against officers, if they even start, get stopped at the grand jury, right? Which is usually like a really secretive process. We saw that in the Breonna Taylor case, right? Where the attorney general in Kentucky just, you know, basically defended the officers in the grand jury, and we never even saw a trial. That we, you know, it's very rare that we see the video on live television, you know? So I think it's a very difficult time for those of us who, you know, were outraged last year around this case to have to watch it all process again. And then we're seeing a deeper level of trauma because we're watching the witnesses come forward, and we're seeing the, you know, the defense try to demonize really the witnesses, as he refers to them, the crowd. Really, these are bystanders who, in my opinion, were only people who showed up in a humane way on that day, right? Begging, pleading for Mr. Chauvin, I'm sorry, not Mr. Chauvin, for George Floyd's life in the face of the indifference from the police officers. And then, as you all were saying, you know, the continued efforts to criminalize George Floyd well after, you know, he's passed and been killed by these police officers, I think it shows a real gap in where police culture is right now, and I think where the rest of our society is, you know, where we, when you look at something like addiction and substance abuse, and the officer's response to people telling them that they didn't need to treat George Floyd like that, being, don't do drugs, right? Chauvin after the fact saying, well, he's on something. And I think most of us are beyond the point where we think the right response to someone dealing with addiction is to show up with force. And so I think, you know, it leaves us with a lot of questions around how we really want to deal with questions of public safety going forward. Yeah. You know, what's the right response to a situation like that? And, you know, it all gets back to the bigger issues around our overdependence on policing. And so I think just like the last thing I would say is just, you know, as we look at this case, I know we all want to see justice for George Floyd and his family, but the idea that a guilty verdict or not guilty verdict fixes things is not right, right? Well, you know, either way, we know that we need some systemic change in these systems as well.
And that leads me right to my next question, because this is beyond just the city of Minneapolis. This is going to have reverberating effects throughout this entire nation when it comes to accountability and what police can and cannot do and what they feel like they can get away with. So how do you think the results of this verdict, one way or the other, will have an effect when it comes to policing in the black and brown community?
Well, I think, you know, if there's a not guilty verdict, it's going to be, you know, it's going to be rage inducing. There's no question about it. We all have to sit here and watch the video over again, listen to the trauma, listen to children who have to come to court and relive what happened, listen to folks of all backgrounds, you know, feeling themselves feeling guilty about not being able to stop this, while there seems to be no remorse on the side of the officers. So I think, you know, a not guilty verdict is obviously going to enrage people. I think it's going to further delegitimize this system, and we're going to see people taken to the streets again. There's no question about that. My hope would be that even with a guilty verdict, that, you know, as I was saying before, we don't let our guard down. I think, you know, even prosecution's case, I understand they are trying to establish that he acted outside of regulations to get a guilty verdict. But in some ways, you know, they are probably unintentionally gaslighting us to tell us that this is not the culture of Minneapolis policing or policing when other officers stood there and watched it happen as well. So I think we're going to have to dig in deep. I was just going to say that in Minneapolis, they have an opportunity with a ballot initiative this November to kind of hit reset on their system of public safety. And I'm hoping that that will be something that people around the country will look to as an example and follow the lead of folks already in Minneapolis.
We're almost out of time, but it does strike me what you said there, right? Because we're seeing, you know, shift supervisors, sergeant, people on the stand who, it doesn't feel like we would normally hear from, in the strongest terms, rebuking one of their own, right? It's just there's the world stage that the George Floyd death exists on. So the defund the police call, and I think you were alluding to that a little bit with some of these initiatives, there is still this divide, even amongst Black people. There's still so much misconception about it.
Yeah, so, I was alluding to it. You know, in Minneapolis, they're taking an approach where they're basically, as I said, hitting reset on public safety, creating a new structure around public safety, not led just by police department, but by overarching Department of Public Safety, right, that would allow for other responses to people going through mental health crises or dealing with addiction or even in resolving conflict and trying to prevent things. I think, you know, I understand that it is scary to talk about public safety as something that we need to experiment with, try different things. We've been given no other option than policing to resolve all of these community issues for, you know, decades. And so it's very hard to shake that. I compare it to the debate around gun violence, where, you know, we have these big moments where we say, there's no way we should be living like this. But at the same time, we have these attachments to these, whether it be police or whether it be guns, since that's going to guarantee us security. I think we have to, you know, be willing to reimagine something new if we're going to improve the situation.